so the title of our presentation is Intuition as Method and Artistic Research. So in Bergsonism, Deleuze claims that intuition as a method is one of the most fully developed methods in philosophy. Yet many still see intuition as an irrational, mysterious faculty. Mario Bunke, the Argentinian-Canadian philosopher of science, goes so far as to write in his book Intuition that in contrast to mathematical and scientific intuition, philosophical intuition winds up becoming a philosophy concocted by perverts or irrational. There's obviously a wide gap between the two camps, and we seek to reconcile various understandings of intuition and Bergson's ideation and the lived expression of intuition's method. Intuition is usually seen as immediate apprehension without the intervention of any reasoning process, and an intuition is a particular result of such apprehension as a phenomenon of mind. Thus, if intuition is aesthetic and sensorially driven, if it is immediate and mediated by academic methodologies, then knowledge thus acquired is deemed to have no validity. However, we can glean from this listing of qualities that intuition bypasses systematic method, yet produces understanding. That there is what to tap into in intuition as direct access to the production of knowledge in a different way as method. The relevance of intuition has all to do with the production of difference. The creator advances novelty and the advancement of invention. Any practice which entails intensive iteration and unremitting repetition of the same gestures, deeds, movements, or activities can be deemed a tabula rasa from which creativity and innovation can emerge. The iterative gesture as sameness is the featureless ground from which any deviation makes itself felt in the instant. The deviation as incipient innovative possibility indicates a possible direction for research as intuitive individuation. Consider a production potter who throws 100 identical pots or bowls in one day. For him, it is all thoughtless automatic gesture. But while throwing bowl 73, his forefinger snags ever so slightly on a patch of clay that would be slick with slip. His attention is pulled to his forefinger. Rather than with it, his years of experience will tell him that he doesn't have to. His intuition is to slightly alter the angle of the second knuckle of the forefinger of his right hand. He goes with it, and the intuition pays off. The tiny gesture dramatically increases the speed with which the clay allows itself to be pulled, and therefore how fast he can throw a bowl. Thus, the craftsman ventures forth into the relative unknown of the recognition of the problematic situation through to its conversion, to its resolution as invention. It is here that humanity makes its own history, Lewis says, and comes into its own as an eager, full-fledged adult craftsman. This type of intuition-based discovery is second nature to artisans, artists, and performers. It is found in any of the iteration-based practices which require the repetition of the same gestures with instruments or tools or the reversal of coordinated interaction with other bodies. Here, innovation is not the result of programmed systematic experimentation with technique or method. It is a direct, non-conceptual, and pre-linguistic determination. The innovation is unmediated and unthought, but its result is clear, repeatable, and confirmable. It is a solution to a problem we didn't know was ever there. Intuition leads forth where method, literally the way of doing things, has become mindless habit, so that straying from methodological path immediately reveals the difference, not of intensity, but of qualitative difference in kind. The familiarity of the iterative process become habit allows the detection of the wavering away from the known. It permits us to deviate from standard practice made perfect to then explore novelty of the what can be done next. Once the difference is discerned within the process of the regularity of perfected habit, intuition opens up the what the process is not to the actualization of potential as the becoming possible of the now or something else. Here, a differential differentiation applies itself into the what something is to the what it is not. Through the what it can be otherwise, and the what it could be. Through the negative, through the possible, and through potential. As Bergson writes, intuition then signifies first of all consciousness, but immediate consciousness, a vision which is scarcely distinguishable from the object seen, a knowledge which is contact, and even coincidence. Any type of deviation from the iterative, any error or mistake that accidentally takes place can be seen as a chance happening. as a stumbling into creation, as a fortuitous production of creative ideas. The polished and featureless flow of production serves as background for the revelation of any chance occurrence or anomalous variation within the habitually salvaged. This ground zero is not a vacuous void of blankness. It is a silent guidance of a preconditioning of creative potential attuned to the enabling constraints imposed by experiential involvement with a craft's tactics, techniques, and materials. It is on this ground zero's background that any movement facilitates aesthetic novelty as an easy form of advancement. To research creative this level is to allow the minutest level of discernment and difference to inflect a practice towards the greater deviation of novelty. If one defines intuition as immediate knowledge, there are two dimensions to intuition which need to be foregrounded. First, the temporally immediate as an instantaneous consciousness of what is at play. Second, the directness of the acquisition of knowledge as an immediate advancement of creation in kind. It's the progress of creativity as pure invention and doing, untrammeled by a prior intellect or memory. In this way, the temporal immediacy of being as experience becomes knowledge as direct understanding through doing. Experience becomes a non-discursive knowledge directly available through doing as informing the unknown. This knowledge is pre-scientific and pre-linguistic. It is unmediated in that it is a direct apprehension of difference as innovative sword. Intuition occurs at the level of the differential, and the moment of intuition in its infinitesimal smallness is a conjunction of differential circumstances that provide the conditions for creative novelty as event. It is a suspicious moment in which the conditions are ripe, charged, pregnant, or saturated with the possibility of emergence, which when given a chance, the odds are that it will produce movement. It is an inflection which mediates the relation so that it emerges from the established path into the novelty of innovation. It is the veering away from the tangent. This deviation is a moment of truth in that it tests to the smallest detail the commitment of the advance into novelty. And the criteria of truth here is not a true or false test of logic, but the coherent opportunity of the moment, of the movement. The proof of the pudding might be in the eating, but the moment of truth of the pudding is in the baking, in the movement, in the transformation from a mixture of human participants and non-human ingredients, techniques, technologies, into a wobbly bowl. The pudding might not be the one expected, but its truth is attested to, and the proof that results is an outcome of the conditions and ingredients that went into it. Thus, the moment of intuition is the interval between the what comes before and what comes after. But it's the unexpected and surprising celerity of passage which produces an effective flash that leaves us breathless or leads us to the pronouncement of the interjection of discovery. Yes, yaha. Yet, how to transmit the immediacy of this knowledge without loss? Deleuze is categorical in stating that intuition is neither feeling and inspiration nor disorderly sympathy, but a fully developed method constituting that which Bergson calls precision and philosophy. However, when it comes to artistic research, Deleuze's intuition as a method is not what most people are looking for. Most people are looking for easy access to surprising insights that intuition offers, as if they were a get-rich-quick scheme for intuitive insight. Sometimes, spontaneity is also confused with intuition. In Foucault, Deleuze defines spontaneity as the capacity to affect or to be affected. So one can speak of being spontaneously receptive and open to intuition. For this to happen, one has to be aware of the advance into getting it, but spontaneity is not intuition. Curiously, I found an expression of Deleuze's method of intuition clearly expressed in an interview with David Mamet. As Mamet says, anyone can write five people trapped in a snowstorm. The question is, how you get them into a snowstorm. It's hard to write a good play because it's hard to structure a plot. If you can think of it off the top of your head, so can the audience. To think of a plot that is, as Aristotle says, surprising and yet inevitable, is a lot of work. And he adds, the basis of drama is a struggle of the hero towards a specific goal at the end of which he realizes that what kept him from it was, in the lesser drama of civilization, in the great drama, the discovery of something that he did not set out to discover, both in retrospectively, he sees as inevitable. The example Aristotle uses, of course, is Oedipus. What is most relevant here is the nonchalant way that Mamet describes the working of narrative structure and the degree of commitment that goes into artistic practice. What I wish to highlight, however, is the process within the curriculum, the process within the practice of the writer as to what is to be gotten from an area, or within the practice of the artist, and what is to be gotten from the artwork. So that here we have a split in the experiential of the artwork. On one side, we have the writer or artist working assiduously on a statement as a formulation of a problem that finds its expression as what is at play in the work of art. And on the other, experiencing the work of art as a transmission of a solution to a problem and its translation as that which is to be got out of the artwork. Both artists and viewers end up with a solution they deserve to the problem they are able to pose. The solution to the problematization of the artwork can be a single, inevitable solution, a multiplicity solution, or a non-solution as a paradox of England, or recursive iteration of the problematization as its own problematization. The intuition encompasses all these outcomes as an expression of the inevitable conclusion we arrive from the way that one problematizes the artwork. The artist's work is a problematizing of research creation not pertaining into closure, but towards the perpetuation of intuition as creative moment. Intuition is productive, not in a willy-nilly manner, but through an exact decisiveness. Intuition is unhesitating, resolute, and determined in its taking action. Intuition is not chancy in itself, but absolutely necessary in its outcome. You may not be aware of the problem you were asking when you had the intuition, but that discovery that takes you by surprise, that moment that informs you of yes, is the obvious result of the appropriate positive problem, of establishing the exact compositional conditions that inevitably yield that result. The realization of the aha moment is a corollary of the realization of the ah shit moment. The ah shit moment is the moment when you realize that the result is not the positive affirmative advance into novelty you were looking for, but the negative detractive digression and failure you were likely trying to avoid. Stop cruising for that, so I'm sure. They simply show a different aspect, but if you look closely, the aha moment and the ah shit moment share the same movement. They simply show different aspects of being involved in the work. However, of the two, the ah shit moment is usually the one that leads to retrospective examination of the precursory conditions, the reconfiguration of the compositional elements, to a different repositioning of the questions in order to reformulate the problem. Failure, unfortunately, seems to emphasize the need to learn from experimental mistakes through a process of denigrative introspection, repetitive rumination, build with self-justification, which apparently are a big aspect of the creative process. Favorable outcomes usually don't lead to immediate introspection because any successful creator is usually too busy basking in the global amount of success. It is the retrospective examination of the precursory circumstances which allow the recreation and reformulation of the conditions for the coming to being of the solution in order to allow the direct immediate transmission of the statement as an intuition for both artists and viewers. In terms of an intuitive dynamic, the experiential in the work of art is a lived act, which is the irreversible conversion of process into specific advancement as difference in kind, produced by, with, and through the work of art, both in terms of practice and as artwork. The aesthetic interaction with an artwork is not a question of guiding the viewer to a preconceived conclusion, but of creating problematizing conditions as an ecology of encounter, as an ecology of relation within the work. The point is to produce the compositional circumstances between artwork and viewer, which will be productive of the appropriate problematization, appropriate in that it will yield a fitting response to the questions the artist is posing. In this respect, to ensure the transmission of a specific statement of the propitious conditions need to be in place that will precisely and exactly reproduce the circumstances or experientially arriving at the appropriate conclusion as an immediate and immediate intuition. Whether or not this happens depends on the precision and exactness in which the original experience posited by the work of artist practice is recognizable in its repetition in the experiencing of the artwork. The bad news here for artists is that in order to attain this clarity of expression, this free-flowing and traveled directness and immediacy towards repetition of the intuition of the aha moment, the proverbial 99% perspiration is required to hone and polish a statement so that it unfalteringly produces the surprising and inevitable intuition in the viewer. This entails the manifold repeated repetition, realignment, and reconfiguration of the conditions and circumstances of compositional elements for them to continually produce the totalizing experience in the right intuition. And this is constitutive of a method that produces aha moments in the sun. In Bergsonism, Deleuze reformulates the method of intuition as gleaned from Bergson. To conceptualize intuition, in intuition's method, he lays out the method in terms of three distinct sorts of acts that in turn determine the rules of the method. The way he does this is by a progressive application of discursive carving away or reduction of possibilities to determine what is ultimately operative as a guiding principle through the tangle of the path of choice. Deleuze cleverly determines what is ultimately productive in intuition, what appraisal of Bergson's ideas. Deleuze, like Bergson before, uses the method he's prescribing to do what he is prescribing. The three rules of the method, stipulated by Bergson, consist of appropriate formalization, differentiating, and conceptualizing. For Deleuze, this involves 1. A critique of false problems and the invention of genuine one, 2. Narrowing and convergence, and 3. Thinking in terms of duration. This is not a step-by-step protocol towards approaching the traditional method, but an offering of strategies towards positing precise and ambiguous problems through the almost instantaneous formulation of its exact and fitting solution. Deleuze quotes Bergson, "The stating and solving of the problem are here very close to being a good one. The truly great problems are set forth only when they are solved." Or in other words, the exact solution reveals in time the real question we didn't know was being posed. And this is essential before formulation of the answer. To know how to resolve a problem decisively, without prevarication, without doubt, to know the why and the how and the now is the exercise of subjective freedom as the expression of intuition. Power to decide to constitute problems themselves is what constitutes true majority. This is to render the problem productive of truth. It proves that it's productive of the operational coherence of the problem and the restatement of its circumstances and conditions through to its possible outcomes as a decisive solution. This is what is mirrored in the method of intuition between the work of art as a thinking doing for the artist and the artwork as a doing thinking for the viewer. Thank you very much.
That's because I took my time.
Yes, we have time for a couple of questions.
I just had a question. You're talking about this aha of the clarity of the expression of the artist.
Yes.
And I was wondering how your theory would deal with, for example, art produced in other eras and other cultures. Or would there some kind of separation between the artist and the receiver? How would you deal with that?
Well, I think there's obviously a difference between the artist and the receiver, but I think that is articulated through the artwork. The artist, whoever it is, produces an artwork that supposedly says something, and that statement is usually articulated through the artwork. The person viewing that hopefully gets the same statement, so there's a certain commonality. But I mean, I think it works cross-culturally. I don't think that the process of intuition is dependent on culture or its artifacts.
Thank you very much. So at one point you mentioned the moment of intuition in terms of a passage, and. Well, I was thinking, I mean, that makes a lot of sense, especially with what you said in your third criteria, which would be sort of thinking through temporality. But interval also, in terms of passage, you know, has a sort of spatial dimension.
Okay.
And I was wondering if you could talk, or if,
sure.
If there's...
Sure. Yeah, I'm not sure what you're saying. Now, I don't know if you noticed, but at the beginning, I brought in the word instant. And for me, the thing about the instant of the now and the moment of the now are completely different things. For me, the instant is a pointless kind of way of seeing becoming as points, and I want to move away from that, which is essentially what you end up as a cartography, as a history and tradition, and what I was trying to get is at the moment as the movement of time, the creation of time. So it's the creation of difference, not as an intensity, but as a difference in kind, and that is what to me, in my mind, intuition does. It's sort of that which makes that move from what was before to the what comes next. And so for me, the phrasing of the moment is very important, because moment for me also implies a leveraging, which in English you can say to leverage is a moment, and a moment always includes a couple of forces. So for me, moment is a really good expression of that movement that's implicit within the advancement into innovation, to creation.
Thank you.
I don't know if that, to me it's like the...
No, it was good. That's helpful.
Oh, okay. Yes?
In this case, if you agree with me about intuition, personal intuition as a method, which is really weird because, I don't know, the epistemological plan, the way we need things, equal the things, the reality. Wow. Thinking in terms of duration is, in fact, become duration. And it's really a little bit problematic. Thinking epistemology and ontology
combined.
If you agree with me?
I was thinking about that last night. And one of the, because I guess there was a section here which sort of dealt with the epistemological aspects of it. To me, intuition, like just coming to think of it, is that intuition is just operative all the time. And if you're, for example, reading it, and you're getting what is being read, right? As you progress through that text, you're getting. It's a progression of intuitive moments. So for me, it's a really cool concept to think of it that way, in the sense that the things that these partial solutions that you're coming to as advancement within the text is what moves the thing forward till you get to the big solution. So you're advancing these partial solutions into the big into a bigger thing, which is the whole thing, which is a statement. And I guess that is, as you're saying, it is an intuitive advance, epistemological advance into big thing. Yeah. So it's, for me, it's like a really cool. He doesn't actually come out and say so like that, but makes me think of it. And it works with the artwork, and it works, at both levels, both at a macro level and a micro level. And the two of them sort of seem to work. So that process actually is what happens.
By the way, for Bert, some of this process is really hard. It's really hard.
Oh, it's very stringent. This is the way it is. But the thing is that is, I guess you come to see it, that process works that way, in the sense that all your choices are always being narrowed. To a particular becoming. And you don't know what that becoming is. It's an indeterminate becoming, but that is what ends up being what it is, inevitably. And so that's why I say that it's completely determinate, but at the moment it is determinate and cutting as definitive of what, and inevitable of what it is going to be.
Thank you.
Speak of increasing discontinuity, when is the moment of the new produced?
The moment is the moment of the new is the moment of intuition, and it's not a discontinuum. That's the thing, is that you're always thinking about continuity, discontinuity. And the thing is that the instant, if you say that life is constitutive of instant, then that is in some way a discontinuous one after the other. But the thing is through the moment of intuition that movement gets blown into it and just like comes out together, which is that continuous construction into it. And that's why I divide that sort of, you have that proverbial line of becoming at that point, with the now, you have a deviation into novelty, and at the same time that you have a spatial determination of that you have that is tied, that is locked in up to here, and then you have the advance of novelty, which keeps pushing like this. I don't know if that makes sense to you, or
you say the proof is in the process rather than the perception of the pudding. I think what I would like to know is maybe just a couple cuts into what you see as the proof of the process and how you this, and to maybe look back on how you've written it. How do you see intuition having a function in your throwing the pots in this paper?
Well, to me, you know, the throwing the pots, I guess, comes from personal experience, from that experience of iterative production processes, where you learn from the repetition, and just that you see that, you know, you can do things without thinking, but then all of a sudden, oh, there's something different, and then you see, okay, oh, from there I can move to do something else. I don't know what the other.
Well, I mean, like in the specific paper.
Yes.
Do I
see if there's a movement of intuition?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think there's small movements of intuition throughout. That's. But I mean, I think conversing with somebody or just like this talking or reading is a very intuitive process because it's all intuitive advancement. Yeah, I don't know if that. I just think it was when I started reading about intuition, I thought, wow, this is a really cool way of thinking of creative advance, of innovation, and process. And so, it was a big link, sort of, in the thinking of the differential and the occurrence of the differential. You know, in for example, you're in the fold or in difference in repetition. You know, the whole question of repetition versus how difference is created. For me, the whole intuitive sort of the whole process of intuition as that moment which pushes things, you know, incipiently on the verge to the next thing is as inevitable is sort of what served as a motor for the philosophy of difference. And so I find it's the small thing that within his work on Bergsonism, but I think it's underplayed and super important concept, to understanding the whole advancement of process. And I think that even if you read Whitehead, but Whitehead I think also works very much in this way. The advancement of apprehension very much works in this way. And you can think of it as a multi-stranded advance, but it still advances on the same line, which is a very intuitive kind of move from the object to the subject to the supergen. It's a very intuitive kind of movement, and you have to, I think, consider it or think of it in terms of intuition in order for it to make sense, for that advancement to really happen and move forward.
Simondon
as well, for sure. But I guess Simondon would be in a different, in a different dynamic. I mean, Simondon through his associative milieu is, I think he conceives things sort of as a different way, but you can still think, the movement within the associative milieu as being productive of intuition, as part of that individuation that generates the entire, associative milieu or the milieus.
Don't have time anymore, but I might say
sure.
The last question did part of I was thinking of Bachelard to some last time.
Uh-huh.
If you see there any connection for me, so
you know what?
In all the days of time, because Bachelard criticized the dogs.
Yes.
Some did. So I was wondering.
I started reading the Bachelard, and it just didn't do it for me. Just like he was like, okay, yeah, you're not working along the sign, along the. I think he also has a book on intuition. But as you assume this now, is that the book?
Yeah, it's about time.
Yeah. I personally don't think he was a good reader in Bergson.
Okay.
And so I didn't pursue it. But that's just me. I'm sure other people find it, very poetic and very moving. But for me, it just wasn't jiving with. With a very specific kind of thought that precise and accurate kind of thinking that the Bergson's work.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.